Hey everybody, and welcome back to the TI5 China Qualifiers. I'm Basekip.
I'm Darker.
And we're back for another game. We've got TongFu versus Wings coming up next, another two-game series, so should be a good one. Darker, any immediate reactions on just seeing the two teams?
TongFu are looking okay. You know, there's nothing special, but this was a team that we kind of worried about. The recent performances haven't been great. They have switched Kabu around quite a lot. He was playing up until recently one role. So he started off playing, you know, 4-5, then off lane, then now hard carry. But this tournament, he's back to off lane. So we'll actually see exactly what they're going to be doing, whether they will switch him up between games, between series, or if he is back to off lane for now. Wings, they're the guys that came through the open qualifier, though. They're the kind of dark horses. They've got a couple of well-known names in July, Super, XCT, but two of the other players, you know, not so well-known. Recent performances
have been... It's really funny looking at Kabu's, his heroes, and you can just see the fact that he's jumped around so much. He joined the team, he played Hard 5, played the Vengeful Spirit, played a bunch of offlane with Clockwork and Timber, and now he's on the one position, but he hasn't had enough games on the one just yet. For that to actually bump out his most played heroes. But yeah, so Kabu's now in the one role.
Well, this tournament he's been playing Timbersaw.
Oh, is he?
And like offlane. So that's what I'm sort of, you know, wondering whether it's a game by game basis.
Because they've played one game so far, right? They've played
one series.
They've played one series. Anyway, but yeah, so TongFu looking all right. And Wings, they're your open qualifier team. They looked pretty good in the open qualifier. I think took most of their games pretty convincingly, and the series that were included there, I think they 2-0'd as well. So yeah, they've been looking all right, and have a little focus in here on in July. He's pretty well known. I mean, as the open qualifier teams go, I feel like Wings actually have a lot of fairly notable players from sort of that tier 2, tier 1.5.
Yeah,
area sort in China.
Old rising stars, DK, you know, they sort of all dissipated and then re-merged. Yeah, exactly. Now Wings Gaming, you know, they're looking pretty good. But into the draft right here, TongFu against the Wings Gaming. Best of two or two-game series. A win here, a 2-0 gets you 3 points in the group stage. A draw gets you 1 point, so heavily prioritizing wins. And I was asking Wagger about this in the previous series. How far do you think teams will go, especially if they win the first game, to get that second win in their hands? Because it seems important, but do you want to take undue risks to get the extra 2 points?
I mean, you're gambling 1 point against two, right? So I feel as though there is a small incentive to, if you feel like you've got something, if your gut says, okay, we've got something that's going to work, we have something potentially prepared, but it might be somewhat untested, I think there's definitely some incentive to busting that out and trying to get the 2-0. But nothing too shocking coming out of the draft thus far. We've got TongFu getting rid of Wisp and Undying. We were talking a little bit during prep about whether or not Wisp was going to be making a lot of appearances. I know that obviously HGT are a team that are going to be picking it a whole lot, but outside of that, we weren't 100% sure for this region whether or not Wisp is going to be seeing a lot of play. But it looks like TongFu not going to let Wings get their hands on that. And the Drowranger also going to get banned out here. So Earthshaker's still there, Shadowfiend's still there.
Spiritbreaker as well.
And the Spiritbreaker as well, yeah.
Like, I kind of put Spiritbreaker up there with Queen of Pain and Shadowfiend. Mm. You know, Earthshaker, I feel, just sort of goes past those heroes. He's so diverse, well, versatile. The fact you can play him offlane and in that support spot. Queen of Pain, you know, you can still throw her into the offlane, safe lane. But I feel like we're seeing less and less of the safe lane co-op that we saw, you know, 2 months ago from Chinese teams, where you'd rush Orchid, then into things like Shadowblade and Skadi and go for like a full carry co-op. Now it's about mid lane, controlling that, controlling runes, and having your supports come to you. Rather than you moving to them.
Yeah, and the Aghanim Scepter as well. I think people have... Because the old kind of adage used to be that it wasn't worth getting the Aghanim Scepter on Queen of Pain until you already had level 16, because you didn't really get the full cooldown benefit until that point. But with a lot of the recent changes to Quap, the Aghs has become even more attractive. And we're even seeing players like CTY just pick it up as their very first item. Sometimes, you know, a Yule Scepter, if they need it against a Skywrath Mage or some other long duration silences, maybe they're playing against a Storm potentially, though we don't see a whole lot of Orchid
now,
Storm.
Now, this was an old Chinese favorite. Batrider used to be, you know, first pick, first ban nonstop for basically years. Like, it sort of transcended patches, transcended any kind of meta. Batrider was there for Chinese teams and Chinese players. Recently, though, we haven't really seen him at all.
Yeah, he's been less popular, sort of overtaken by some other offlaners. I feel like his jungle has become quite crowded recently in terms of we're seeing lots of Shadow Fiend mid, we're seeing lots of Storm Spirit mid. And in general, teams are almost always grabbing at least one hero that can clear out stacks
Whatnot. So you're picking like Lina in the fourth spot that also wants to go and take jungle camps.
So you don't need the Batrider so much to be able to take advantage of the jungle that way. But still an amazingly solid hero. I mean, even with all of the nerfs, we still see him from time to time. And I feel like every single time I see him picked, it's never like, oh man, you know, what a terrible Batrider game they had. This is a little bit dangerous because I feel like they've left themselves vulnerable picking it this early. There's still a Vengeful Spirit in the pool, and TongFu, I mean, they've already got Shadow Fiend. They're over on the Dire. It adds Roshan potential. It's a good counter against the Bat, so I would not be surprised at all to see the Vengeful Spirit even in this pick from them, but it's a little bit difficult to get a read on what Wings have been up to, especially since all of their recent matches have pretty much just been the open qualifier.
With TongFu, they also have things like Shadow Demon Leshrac, Shadow Demon Lina to actually go for, but the Bounty Hunter here picked up by TongFu, and this, again, something we were talking about in prep, the four-spot bounty.
Yeah, I think this is pretty signature for them. I think TongFu and CDEC are the two teams that stand out to me as sort of your support Bounty Hunter teams. So, in general, I mean, we've been seeing it more often than not just used to put some pressure on middle lane, try and snipe a courier, perhaps. Track, of course, is amazing now with the 4-second cooldown. You're pretty much every single kill while Bounty Hunter is alive should be a track kill. So I kind of understand that we're starting to see more of him. We'll see what he gets done this game. This might be a tiny bit early because we don't know exactly what Wings are going to be taking for their mid roll. And while we haven't, I feel like I'm maybe hammering this point a little bit too much, and maybe this is me going back a couple of patches, but whenever I'm looking at these drafts and I'm seeing stuff like the Visage, I'm always thinking, okay, have TongFu made themselves vulnerable by not having a good enough defensive tri-lane? Because Bounty Hunter is not good tri-lane versus tri-lane at all.
When you look at VG at the summit, they had, what, Visage Pogna plus one, plus a Rubick or something like that in aggro tri, and it completely crushes people. So I agree. Bounty Hunter, sure, he's disruptive. He's good at moving around the map and controlling runes, I think, especially. Maybe controlling mid lane a little bit, but I'm not too sure. Batrider, if you put him on that safe lane, he's going to get pretty much guaranteed farm at some rate. He's not going to be stopped completely. And coming back to the point you made about the jungle, with the nerf, you know, slight nerf to the bounties of jungle creeps, there have been, on occasion, moments where you have a Batrider on your team, he gets shot out of lane, he's level, you know, 1.5, level 2, goes to the jungle and realizes, hang on a second, this isn't working as well.
It just takes
for me.
Forever.
It does. Like, I've seen games where you kind of expect Bat to get, you know, 9 to 12 minute blink dagger because he's done decently on lane, farms the jungle a bit, ends up being 20 minutes in, no blink dagger, and the game's pretty much over. Yeah. But obviously, you know, that's a small portion of the games we see. Gyrocopter here for Wings Gaming, no big surprise. Rocket Barrage and Soul Assumption throwing out that magical damage.
Yeah, before the recent nerfs, we were seeing pretty much Gyrocopter early pick every single game. I was doing a lot of casting for the Mars TV Dota 2 League, the China qualifier there, and Gyrocopter was definitely a massive staple. So we haven't seen it quite as much thus far here in the TI5 qualifiers, but it looks like we're still going to be seeing him somewhat. I think, like you said, still a pretty strong hero, good synergy with Visage, stacking up that damage so you can get more soul assumptions out. And this could also be the beginnings of looking towards aggressive tri-lane, since Gyrocopter is a very capable tri-lane versus tri-lane here. This could also be the beginnings of some kind of greed if they're looking for it, because they could, just because of how good Gyrocopter is in lane, they could probably get away with being a tiny bit greedier on their supports.
Well, Wings, respecting Kabu, banning out that Clockwork, and that has been one of their prioritized picks over the past couple of weeks, definitely giving him the respect that he deserves, but they're taking a lot of time here to think about their fourth. It's going to be a Lion, so they've got a lot of aggressive potential here. Now, you're talking about TongFu and maybe not having a defensive tri lane. It's definitely looking like the Wings have got the tools at their disposal to go out and make kills, regardless of aggro tri lane and putting themselves up on that top Radiant lane, or just having, you know, a Visage and Gyrocopter bot Lion moving around and helping mid.
Yeah, they've definitely got that option on the table. And TongFu do something that we don't see a heck of a lot. They've grabbed the Shadow Fiend and the Storm Spirit together. So it looks like we are going to be seeing... I would guess probably... I'm actually guessing that it might be Storm Spirit safe lane and Shadow Fiend mid. Of course, it's going to depend on what the mid pick is for Wings. They've still got options. They can run it in multiple different ways. It's going to depend on who they think has the best kill potential when added to the Bounty Hunter against whatever is being run mid. But this draft does strike me as a little bit strange from TongFu this far. Wow. And they go for a Legion now, Commander, which
this
I'm not a fan of this hero. I'm going to be straight up. I'm probably even a little bit biased. I just don't think that this hero is well suited.
This is a hero we saw from them earlier today.
I believe so, yeah.
It was against Undying, and I kind of thought, huh, okay, well, press the attack gives, you know, attack speed, and we were trying to figure out, I don't think we got an answer. Do you know if Overwhelming Odds works on the zombies? Not damage-wise, but does it buff up Overwhelming Odds to give extra damage and move speed?
Does
it use those targets?
Do they count as a unit for the purposes of Overwhelming Odds? I'm honestly not sure.
Yeah, it was this odd one that no one on the couch knew, and it's sort of like, maybe, maybe not. But I saw Legion Commander as a counter to Tombstone. You know, you press the attack, you walk in, you hit the Tombstone, it's dead. And then maybe you go and look for a duel. But it looks like this is a hero that they've been practicing. You know, it's been tried, tested. It hasn't worked today so far, but we'll see. Red has been playing it. He's had a couple, an iffy series earlier, but obviously it's still early days.
Yeah. I believe, so does the, press the attack, the spell is lasso, right?
Yes.
So there is that aspect. I feel like they're fairly well equipped against the Batrider. Of course, you're not picking Legion Commander because she has a dispel and that it works against the Batrider, but there is that aspect to it. And they're also, I think, fairly well equipped against the Bat because of the Bounty Hunter. You can be out scouting. If he has a track on anybody, it makes it pretty easy to keep tabs on what the Bat is up to. And TongFu round out the lineup with a Caudle. Is this a dual offlane Legion Commander Keeper of the Light with
and spam overwhelming
mega,
odds?
Mega overwhelming odds spam. I want to see it. I don't know what exactly they're doing. Could be safe lane as well. But they have to do something a little bit funky with their lanes because they've got three sort of non-traditional offlane cores. I know that Legion Commander Bone7 does play it in the offlane, and I feel like he's the one person that really gives Legion some respect as a hero, and nobody else really picks it, but... We'll see what TongFu end up doing with it here.
Legion could be, in Radiant Jungle... stealing camps, stopping Visage from actually doing anything, because we're talking about Wings having relatively aggressive heroes with the Lion of Visage able to pump out a lot of damage, but they also need levels. If they're stuck in a situation where they're hiding in the trees waiting for TongFu to do something, they're not stacking, they're not gaining experience, and they're leeching from the Gyrocopter, they could get caught in a rut, pretty much. While TongFu, although they spread themselves thin, they've got Bounty moving in between lanes acting as a buffer. So you can see Storm against Bat. Okay, maybe the Bat has a slight upper hand early on with Napalm and Firefly and pushing out lanes. Overload and Remnants kind of balances that out. So, it's nowhere near a 60-40. It's probably like a 55-45 or something like that. Batrider can then also go off to the large camp and pull it across, seeing as his Radiant. So I think that gives him that slight advantage. With the Bounty there, swings it completely the other way. Storm suddenly has a pretty massive overruling run over that Batrider up at top.
Yeah, I definitely think that there's some interesting things going on this game for both sides. I really just want to see how the lanes shake out and how things end up going. Last pick for Wings did end up being a Viper, so I mean nothing too shocking, honestly. Little kind of a boring hero on the whole, but it seems solid this game. I think it just gives them a little bit extra. Laning power, hero that, I mean, doesn't do all that well against physical damage, so I think the Legion Commander Shadow Fiend, as things drag on a little bit, are going to give him a decently hard time, but I feel like they just wanted somebody who could buy a mech and kind of hit a timing that the Gyrocopter and the Batrider are also sort of looking at, which is, one or two items on the Gyrocopter, maybe just his first item BKB, blink on your Batrider, mech on your Viper, and you're ready to go and get things done.
Carle.
Oh, you got some lag issues?
Just a tiny bit. It seems like it's me causing these lag issues. Like, I had it on that PC earlier. Waga was fine. I come onto this PC and now it's lagging a little bit.
It's chasing you.
Yeah, it's anyway.
So, we'll do quick introductions before we get too far underway. I don't think there's any skirmish action happening here at level 1. So, over on TongFu, we've got Red, on the Legion Commander, heading towards the offlane here with some boots. First, Melody Lovers is on the Keeper of the Light. We've got Unine on the Shadow Fiend. Kabu is going to be on your safe lane, Storm Spirit, it would seem. And finally, over in the Radiant Jungle at the moment, we've got LPC off on a little bit of an expedition.
I would do the Radiant, but I'm loading into game. You can have that honor.
Okay, so over on Wings, we've got Injuli on the Batrider. We've got Super, small Super, on the Visage.
Not Super!
Not Super with the exclamation mark.
Super.
And we've got XDD on Gyrocopter. We have JDH on Lion. And this is
ZY
on the Viper. So a couple of, well, like we were saying during the... before we got into the game, some familiar faces here from the Chinese scene in general, and well, we'll just have to see how they go. I believe that this should be their first match, right? We've only had four matches played thus far, so I don't think
Wings first match.
Yeah, this is their
TongFu
first join.
Played earlier
against HET, and they got raffle stomped.
Yes, they did.
Yeah, which is kind of sad for them, but. Yeah. I mean, looking to start dragging things back. And we were talking about this as the tough group, right? So I feel like if TongFu get 2-0'd by Wings here, that could end their qualifier run right then and there. Because it's this team, well, this group has CDEC in it. It has
HGT
as well. And they're both looking really strong at the moment. So TongFu going to have to start racking up some wins if we're going to keep them in that sort of top three contention here. But we're underway now. We've got a bunch of anti-invis on the Visage at the moment, so he's prepped for the Bounty Hunter. I don't know where the second sentry has gone. They've actually already used it down on the bottom side here. So they were kind of anticipating that the Bounty Hunter was going to start off towards the offlane. And they're right. LPC is down here at the moment.
They know he's there.
Be a nuisance. And needs to be careful. JDH playing dumb at the moment, trying to wait, I think, until they get everybody in position. Super comes around the corner as well. They spot him. But, okay, no, nothing going to happen. I still think that, at least from the Bounty's perspective, he probably thinks that he hasn't been seen yet. So he may try make another attempt at the lane at some point.
Blocking out camps. Cheeky devil.
Just being a nuisance. I mean, why not? Prevent the pulls. I think this is a big part of the Bounty Hunter pick as well this game. I mean, as much as Wings don't have, say, the Shadow Fiend mid to necessarily clear out stacks, they do definitely want to try and stack up the jungle for their Batrider if they can, and denying that is well worth it, I think. But the downside is that there's only two heroes top, so...
I think the big deal is that they place the sentry to deward this pull camp, so now they're going to be thinking, hang on, is it warded up?
Oh, LPC is going to get dusted. He got slowed by the Grave Chill, but JDH had already used the Hex, and... unfortunately, XCD not going to be able to get in range for the Rocket Barrage there. Red takes full advantage of the opportunity to go and grab a couple of CS and uses the space.
He's two behind the Gyrocopter.
Actually, yeah.
The Gyro missing out a little bit there. But yeah, the Sentry Ward placed looking for that Observer. Or the Sentry to block out this camp. So Bounty Hunter, a little bit of mind games here. I don't know if the supports over on Wings will be thinking, hang on, do we need to buy another Sentry? Do we need to look for this Observer or D-Ward a little harder? Or do we just wait? And it looks like they just waited out. The camp spawns, and they're like, oh, it was the Bounty Hunter all along.
Yeah. So they're going to be able to start running some pulls now. I'm a little bit surprised that we aren't seeing the Keeper of the Light down bottom at the moment. I mean, I know that it's fine that he's over here and sort of taking advantage of his jungle a little bit. Unfortunately, well, they've actually opted to block out the big camp here to prevent the side pull. I don't know if he's found any time to go and do any stacking. It looks like not just yet. He's just kind of been focusing on trying to zone out the Batrider thus far, though. In July, since there's only two heroes up here, is actually getting a decent amount out of this top lane. He's got ATS, he's got level 3.5. This is a pretty happy start if you're Batrider.
Yeah, that side pull is a big part of Batrider offlane. Batrider offlane on the Radiant side, though, so it's a great job that they've warded that. Unusual ward from the Bat, though, himself. The Radiant ward off here does give them vision of people transitioning from camp to camp, but now... heading off into the jungle. Keeper of the Light still standing here and waiting. It's time to go and farm up some jungle camps, I think. Or at least stack them.
Yeah, I think he could be doing a little bit more at this time. I mean, as we've seen from AUI and a couple of other players since, the Keeper of the Light does possess totally ridiculous farming potential if he's left unchecked. So looking forward to maybe seeing a little bit of that and of Melody Lovers. We haven't really touched base with our mid lane in a little bit. It's 22-4 on the Viper up against a 15-0 Shadow Fiend. So SF a little bit behind, but as is kind of the nature of the hero, he's going to get his levels, he's going to bottle crow, and he's just going to spam the wave. And Viper, it's totally impossible for him to maintain creepy equilibrium against the Raze, so eventually Shadow Fiend's going to catch up. And
you just start shoving, that lane. And Viper is also a hero that, you know, deals relatively well with this Bounty Hunter. He's not going to get critted, slowed, and raised down. He can still make his way back to the tower. And with that Ring of Aqua, throwing out poison attacks. Now, what rune regen for the Shadow Fiend? Batrider up at top, though. Kabu slowing him down. And Kabu, you know, we talking about his position and his role association earlier on in the draft. He is back on that one role, which it kind of surprises me that he is switching.
Yeah, I feel like he is a versatile player, so I feel like he's still getting a lot done. But it does, you know, there is something to be said for consistency in practice. We've got some action happening top lane. LPC actually in some trouble. The turnaround comes as JDH is actually here waiting behind. Injuli still in some trouble though. It's Vortex back, couple of auto attacks, a little bit of Perfect World lag as well, but it looks like Injuli is going to be all right and is going to be able to make his way back. So really good positioning, JDH, right place, right time, and they're actually going to end up being the team that draws the first blood there. Lion also getting up to level 3 after that.
That Perfect World lag, they're going on a Visage at bottom lane. LPC slows him down, but Red doesn't have anything to actually add to this fight. With XDD walking in from the side, Rocket Barrage at level 3. And you don't want to be walking into that 2 versus 2, really. Because Super also has level 2 Soul Assumption.
Yeah, they're poking and prodding a little bit, but the Bounty Hunter's not contributing a heck of a lot to these ganks. He's actually gone for the Shuriken Toss as well, so he's just got a little bit of extra nuke potential here, which does make chasing and getting auto attacks off a little bit difficult. I mean, Gyrocopter is relatively squishy. If you hit him with a good overwhelming odds in the middle of a creep wave, then they might be able to get a kill there. But like you said, it's so dangerous, especially when you're a double melee hero lineup trying to find that gank. But
Bounty quite often, you know, if you get things done early and you make an impact, a lot of it, like we've mentioned, is controlling jungle, controlling runes, and being that distraction, making sure that people are looking out for you and really try to counter you, placing sentries all the time. But you do need experience and gold. You need some semblance of actual, you know, domination on the map. And right now we're sitting at level 2. Places a very deep observer ward. What's this actually going to be scouting out for? Batrider farming?
Yeah, I think so. I think they're just trying to get a little bit of information if there's any stacks there. They'll see the Batrider if he's farming, if the supports are off, actually trying to set up the stacks. Because they do have a very good lineup to go and steal those stacks.
Snipe in the Radiant Jungle. There. Not going to get the second hit.
Yeah, unfortunately. If he had no Janata. Yeah.
No, it still wouldn't have killed it off, would it?
Probably not quite, but would have probably been a little bit closer. But anyway, in terms of our overall situation at the moment, Viper is top of the charts on last hits denies, and he's actually really destroying the Shadow Fiend. We were talking about U9 and SF and just being able to spam and do just fine with the lane that way, but he's 48 and almost 50 and 20, and the Shadow Fiend is still all the way down at 30 CS here. So,
Red at bot lane takes a full Rocket Barrage and does get taken down to level 1. Shuriken does nothing as the cooldown from Gyrocopter will catch that bounty. They went aggressive on XDD, and he shows them what for.
Yeah, I'm going to try a very quick reconnect as well, just because this.
Yeah, I just got the 2 kill messages all of a sudden out of nowhere. Yeah. Visage throwing like a 5-second delayed Soul Assumption.
Yeah, things are getting a little bit dicey. Everybody get off the Wi-Fi.
They're probably on different lines. I'm pretty sure they'd be on different lines.
I would
streaming
think so.
Line, Wi-Fi line, have the iPads all connected to that strong streaming line. But yeah, 3-0, 8 minutes into this game. TongFu, you know, their lane's starting to look a little bit shaky. 54 last hits over on that Viper, so Mech is not far away at all. 49 on the Gyrocopter, Storm, and Shadow Fiend. Are big mid-game impact heroes, though. Along with the Legion Commander, if she can get a relatively fast timing on that Blink Dagger, they can go around to make things happen. But then you also have to factor in this Batrider in July. He's going to be heading into the jungle right now.
Yeah, he's doing pretty well, almost level 6. So he's definitely looking good there. Yeah, got Keeper of the Light. We are definitely starting to see more and more of him recently, which has been, I think, totally justified. This hero has a lot of untapped potential in my mind. I feel like people still aren't taking sort of full advantage of the cooldown reduction on Chakra, and there's even, you know, recall shenanigans that we are still yet to see from every team that's picking Caudle. So
kind of unfortunate for LPC. He's trying to leech experience, but yeah, too far away. That would have been a really hefty amount of XP, probably push him up to level 4, but not going his way.
Yeah, he's not had the most impressive game thus far in the support bounty. He's got 3 CS, he's got 2 deaths. Just all of his moves have been countered somewhat. He comes in running down on XDD, Skeki going to be able to get this kill. Rocket Barrage turns it back around, and this is the problem. He's only got so much burst. The cooldown gets dropped, the animation is extremely laggy, but they do get that kill over the
top lane. Storm Spirit, Kabu finds JDH, but the hex out means that the chasing here is going to be a full-on dive behind the tier 2. Earthspike, I think, misses there because Kabu dodges it. No, it didn't even get cast.
Oh, well, so
it makes you sort of double guess yourself. You kind of expect the Earthspike to get thrown there, but you don't see the animation.
Yeah, so Kabu picking up the first kill of the game for his team here, at least dragging things back somewhat. Looks like he's just going for the Bloodstone build. He has his point booster up at the moment, and yeah, just sort of trucking along. Shadowfiend not too far behind on net worth either. Unain, despite what we were looking at, a slightly slow start on CS, is now right back up there. I mean, again, he's just Shadowfiend. End of the day, it's pretty hard to keep him locked out. LPC looking for things in between the two towers. JDH once again, though, right on his tail, pops down the sentry and just shoos him away. So
no dust.
Yeah, this bounty has not had a lot of success, and they picked it second. So I feel like they have put quite a bit of emphasis and quite a bit of priority on the Bounty Hunter's impact this game and being able to get the laning stage off to a good start just because of the Bounty Hunter's rotations, and it maybe hasn't gone exactly to plan. But it looks like they're going to give him the lane for a little bit. We've got the Storm Spirit heading over into the jungle somewhat, and they are going to catch him back up and get him at level 6, so he should still have a decent impact this game.
Where are Wings going?
I think this is the all the way around wraparound gank.
The smoke, and then at the very end of the smoke, Fire Red, the Visage Familiar, is flying over the top. He pops the call, but that's his end. Soul Assumption, lag, XDD, cooldown. Yeah, it's going to land onto the TPing in LPC. Now caught, as in July. Lasso onto Melody Lovers, I believe. Kabu is entering the fight, though, as the Requiem of Souls slows down, debuffs everyone. Gyrocopter, not long for this world, as Kabu does find him with the Ball Lightning, and what looked like, you know, a decent, easy pickoff for Wings turns into an absolute destructive force. TongFu, good reaction there, TPing pretty much everybody in.
Yeah, they just had to dive so far to finish up that kill. Like, they knew that they had the Legion Commander totally dead to rights, so they were hoping to conserve spells for the ensuing fight, but it just... Yeah, that was probably a dive too far. And, I mean, well done by TongFu. They brought everybody in and managed to turn that one around nicely. That's going to even things up. 6-5, our overall scoreline now. I don't know what the graphs are looking like. We can have a very quick squiz experience. Actually, now a reasonably hefty lead in TongFu's favor. Net worth is actually going to be touching down for the second time this game over onto the dire side. So with all of that, they do pick up a lot of momentum for themselves. And Kabu's still on the hunt. He's looking towards XDD. Get the Vortex back. A couple of TPs coming in as well. The Familiar drops, keeping Kabu locked down. Cooldown coming in as well. Melody Lovers looks like he's going to be the one that ends up falling here, as the Viper Strike also ends up being used. And, well, fortunately, Kabu does manage to make it out. And they drew a couple of TPs, but still definitely not what they were looking for, end of the day. It just goes to show how hard it is to try and kill off this Gyrocopter when you can't keep him chained up. As soon as he pops the Rocket Barrage in, the cooldown gets dropped, you often have to just try and disengage as best you can.
We're seeing a lot more prioritization of drums in Chinese games. You know, we're seeing Phantom Lancer on mid lane.
Nine getting lassoed back here on mid. Do they have more lockdown from the line? No, but they do have a Finger of Death. Hex comes out as well. Death Requiem gonna deal a bit of damage there, and up. JDH might have to get out of here safely. LPC lobs the shuriken. Unfortunately, not able to get off a track for that one, but... or did he? Was there a track used? No. Okay, I think he may have actually just leveled up to 6. They threw the track over onto XDD. Blast comes out, super running forward along with the familiars, has a fully charged soul assumption, but there is no one to hit at the moment, so he's just gonna have to hang on to that. Durka is still struggling with horrendous lag at the moment.
Like,
I at least have, I have like Dota.ppt, you have just Dota.png over there.
Like, we're talking a good 7 or 8 seconds. Like, I was looking at the clock, the in-game clock, to actually gauge how bad it was, and there was a good 7 or 8 seconds between my game time being paused and then when it refreshed and actually kicked in again. Yeah. Perfect world.
Anyway.
Hopefully I'll get myself back into
at least
the game.
Our connection to it. It's just a bit problematic. Anyway, Red has been able to pick up some levels and a little bit of farm on the offlane. This is kind of the problem with offlane Legion Commander, I think, in general. It's just there's no guaranteed catch-up. You compare it to a Batrider or a Darkseer or anyone
Tidehunter
really
Ancients,
in the offlane.
Bristleback Ancients, there's
yeah.
plenty.
A lot of your popular offlaners at the moment have at least a decently quick recovery mechanic. Yeah, of course, Legion Commander can head into the jungle a little bit and grab some kind of slow farm there. Oh, Melody Lovers gets lassoed, but the immediate dispel, right place, right time from the Legion Commander in wings. Just going to have to disengage out now. Kabu's got plenty of mana, comes balling in, does get stunned up, eats a Soul Assumption, Rocket Barrage, looks like it is going to be enough to finish him off. Couple of tracks coming out, but the fight turning back the opposite way as Viper also turns up. Viper strikes up Red, and we'll just be able to auto-attack him down. TongFu lose 3. It looked great after they got the dispel on the lasso, but Wings still had all the firepower that they needed.
Yeah. In comes the artillery, literally. You know, call down, Soul Assumption being spammed out a couple of times, and Viper, what itemization have we got for him so far? He's got the mech treads, he's tanked up a lot, 1,000 gold in the bank, and I am back in the game with no lag. Happy as Larry. So I can actually click on things. It's lovely.
I'm over here. I'm over there. I can draw on the minimap. So after that, probably a fairly substantial swing towards Wings. XCD actually benefiting a lot from that fight. He's got his Ogre Club picked up now and another 2k gold on top of that. So BKB should be coming out before too long. Legion Commander is still struggle town, unfortunately, for Red right now. And I feel like the one big way to sort of get this Legion back into the game is to try and move around a little bit with the Bounty Hunter to set up kills, but unfortunately, for the time being, they need the Storm Spirit as initiation. And a 3-man gank is somewhat obvious from the TongFu side right now. So they're caught in a little bit of a catch-22 situation where the Legion Commander, the best way for her to farm her blink would be to go and gank, but they can't really gank without the blink. So it looks like Red's just going to have to take the slow path and smack some creeps. As Wings just going to move into position for this top tier 1. TongFu, not without an answer though. They head in for the mid tier 1 tower. Super looks for the deny, but won't be able to find it.
Yeah, looking at the Dar of Zoes right now, very defensive around their own jungle. You notice that the one over on this ramp, it is watching Rune Spot, but it's also watching the ramp heading up into their jungle. Then the one over to their large camp in the far west, sure, it watches the ramp up from the river to the top lane. But that is in such an awkward spot, they do not want that to be dewatered. I think that's the main thing there. They want to know exactly when people are moving in. It's also a relatively common spot for Batrider to sort of, you know, hold himself down, move from side shop to that jungle camp, and then try and steal jungle camps
Wings
himself.
Are smoked. Are they going to try and mount the defense for this tier 1 bottom? Glyph screen popped. Batrider comes flying in over the top. Try to find somebody. LPC invis. It's going to scout things out somewhat, and tower does just end up falling to the Dire. Without any kind of team fight happening. Looks like, I think XCD may have been the decisive voice there in terms of whether or not they were going to take that fight, because he was like 50 gold away from finishing his BKB right as they would have started that, and he definitely wants to get that one delivered before they look for anything.
He even used cooldown to farm up there.
Yeah.
But he does have his BKB now, ready and available. Familiar is going to scout out Roshan as TongFu have smoked themselves up as well. U9, Kabu heading towards mid, the vanguard there, but this is one of the things about TongFu's lineup. They don't have one hero to really go and initiate outside of Storm at this stage. We're still looking for the Legion Commander, who is 100 gold away from Blink. One small creep camp, go and kill some creeps. You've got your Blink, you've got a TP. You can actually go and join the fight in a couple of seconds if you wanted to.
Yeah, Red. Just running back at the moment. He could even sell his Stout Shield at this stage. Yeah, okay, just going to sell the Stout. Buys up the Blink Dagger. Wings 5-manning for the time being, so it does make initiation really difficult for the Legion here. But, I mean, Wings don't have the best counter initiation in the world. They do have the mech on the Viper, which is pretty scary, and the hero is pretty tanky in general at the moment. It looks like Wings are just going to keep on sieging. The Keeper of the Light is doing his best to hold things back at the moment with the blast, but Wings have this anchor in the Viper. It looks like they're going to try and pincer in here somewhat, but LPC gets caught off to the side. Red jumps in, gets the lasso off. In July might actually be in some trouble here, but it's three heroes inside of the cooldown. Big damage comes out, three down. TongFu still fighting. Red just barely alive. He's going to end up dropping. Picks up a triple in the midst of that fight, in fact. And Kabu with a little bit of mana left in the tank, looking for this kill over on the Viper. A few more auto attacks being traded. But it looks like Kabu is going to be the victor. We've got uphill miss. Why did he cede the high ground? Shouldn't have run down into the river. Looks like he's still going to die to the corrosive skin. No, gets the regen off of the Bloodstone. And he's going to end up being all right. So overall trade ends up being a 4-for-3. Very close to being a 3-for-3 there. But, oh, 3-for-4 the other way.
Like, that looked like Gyrocopter was going to clean up. With a cooldown of flat cannon, there were like 3 or 4 heroes just there in range in AoE. But somehow, Kabu dodges through. He zips, he zaps, he zigs, he zags, and you just don't know where he's coming from. Choosing very wisely what targets he goes for. Mech on the Viper, you know, a little bit early, but TongFu showing that they can put up a good fight. Even though LPC had been holding ground up on this top, sort of this top plateau area, there was a sentry there ready and waiting. JDH was moving back and forth saying, hey, look, I'm going to get a little bit aggressive here. I don't know if the bounty knew exactly what the lion was doing. But in the end, it's the Batrider blowing lasso onto a relatively sort of unimportant target. You want that for the Storm. You want it for the Shadow Fiend. That is your primary form of initiation and disable. Okay, LPC's caught.
LPC trapped in the tree.
I'm sorry.
He's just going to put down a ward, throw a track. I mean, realizing that he is 100% dead. And this ward may even be scattered since they actually dropped a... They've dropped a bunch of sentries around the place as well. So if they head up onto the high ground, they're going to find that one. But another kill for Wings. And, well, despite that teamfight being a pretty big win for TongFu, they're just going to pick themselves up, dust themselves off, and get right back to it. Biggest winner, I think, for that last teamfight was Red picking up the triple. That's going to almost complete his blade mail in one fell swoop out of those kills. So Legion Commander starting to look a little bit better poised to participate in this game, but
no
Wings
duel wins
are still marching forward. Yeah, it's still no duels just yet, unfortunately.
Shadow Fiend getting closer to that BKB himself. Bounty Hunter, I noticed that this null, you know, 15 minutes ago or whatever, 10 minutes ago, and I'm sitting here wondering, is he going for the Dagon build on Bounty? It's something we've seen from bounties which are far ahead. Because you just go around with level 4 Shuriken and Dagon, you zap people and they're gone. But what do you feel this is for? He's got Urn. Oh, zip forward. JDH caught. Kabu. Vortex. But now the stuns from the Flayers. Not ready yet. Storm cooldown. The Finger of Death. Not enough. Kabu gets up to the high ground. Now the chase turns the other way as LPC is in the midst of things looking for JDH. But ZY slows him down with a poison attack and does kill off the bounty. But that's not the kill. Again, that's not the kill they wanted. They wanted the Storm.
Red's still looking for something here, goes blinking up onto the high ground, but won't be able to find anything. The press the attack was perfect there. The Storm Spirit, I think, still had a tiny bit of the lasso duration left on him as Red came blinking in and cast it, gets him out, he ball lightnings away, and that totally salvages things for TongFu there. So I think this is the closest game that we've seen thus far on this stream today.
I don't
want to jinx it.
Waga did this in the previous game. It was old boys, and they...
And then it just went...
No, seriously, like 30 seconds after he said it, oh, this is a close game.
Is this desk even made of wood? Can I...
can
I touch wood?
I'm not sure.
Oh, well. It's all right. I'm
production in
sure
right. Yep.
Okay, so...
But yeah.
What have we got? We've got the Blade Mail now up on the Legion Commander. Wings heading over into Roshan. This is not a particularly quick one. They do have the medallion over on the Visage to help out a little bit.
Rocket Barrage, like, this is something that a lot of people are sort of realizing. I think Eternal Envy was tweeting this out the other day, saying, hey, Rocket Barrage, sure, it's magical damage, but it's got short cooldown, does a ton of damage.
They're coming in to try and fight this one, but they don't have their Storm Spirit here just yet. Duel comes out, LPC getting bursted. Red in some trouble, but he gets the duel win off. Blade Mail also popped. Returning fire a little bit, but it's a double kill already for XED. U9 channels up the Requiem. BKB keeping him somewhat safe, but he's still going to end up being right-click down. Kabu does finally end up joining this fight, I think brought in by the Keeper of the Light. Oh. He finds a kill in the backlines, and he manages to TP out.
Is that another mix-up hill?
It might have been. But, okay, that's going to end up being a 3-for-2 fight. And
well worth it for TongFu, you got to say.
I mean, they
it's not TongFu, sorry, for Wings.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, God.
For some reason, my brain said TongFu. No, they get Roshan. Right. The fact that Jarokov has that BKB, he literally walks into the midst. He's got SNY 1600 gold, so he can go into lifesteal next, go into more damage. But I agree. You called it at the very start of the fight. Storm was not there. He has been their impact hero. He's been the guy that's been choosing which targets to go for, and it definitely sort of feels like he's the shot caller in these team fights. Like, I'm going to go for this guy. You go and try and distract him and go for the other guy.
Was he getting recalled? Was that the plan? I think that may have been the idea there. So they were still trying to bring him in, but it's not quite as fast as, okay, I'm instantly there. I'm ready to fight in. Fractions of a second always matter in these big fights.
And then Unain is forced on the high ground to wreck him into a BKB gyro, a Viper with corrosive skin and mech. Just not optimal situations for TongFu. They wanted to contest that Roshan so badly, though.
Yeah. So they've got some issues now, I think, because XCD with this Aegis can probably afford to. Oh, they're going to jump in top lane. They're looking for the Viper. Good physical damage. It's going to be a track and a duel. So actually a very good pickoff there for TongFu. That's going to be, I think, is that Kabu's BKB completed? Not quite yet, but he is getting very close at the moment. And he's up to 15 Bloodstone charges. The two deaths that he's narrowly avoided has let him really start to build this up.
Where's he going now? Where's he being sent? Bot lane.
Where's the adventure continue?
Keeper of the Light. Oh, there we go. Chakra magic. Here's some more mana like he didn't need, like he needed it.
You know, bring him down bot, give him a pat on the back, give him some mana.
On your way.
Tell him to keep hitting some creeps. Yeah. Kabu is definitely the man of the hour at the moment for TongFu.
Medallion up on the Bounty Hunter, so still relatively squishy, but we're seeing this quite a lot. Go for, you know, Solar Crest. Even things like Rod of Atos on the Bounty to tank yourself up and boost up your mana pool is always great. Agadems for the Keeper of the Light, halfway done. So he's going to have that heal during the daytime, the permanent ghost form or ethereal form, whatever you want to call it. It's going to be pretty scary because Wings, pushing high ground, they need to win a team fight first. Sure, they've got familiars and they've got Viper to sit up on high ground and Gyro to do these massive AoE team fights, Batrider to catch people out, but you're walking into massive AoE spam from TongFu with Illuminate, Razors, and overwhelming odds. So, sure, you've got good catching and decent high ground power. In any other game, I would say Wings doesn't have too much of a problem actually going up to take tier 3s. In this game, Storm buying back as well is going to be a massive factor if he does die. And with a BKB, it's going to be difficult.
Scary. That's definitely scary. I think at this point, Wings are just aiming 100% to try and get the lasso onto Kabu if they can. But like you said, there's always the press the attack available. So that's not even a guaranteed kill. And often, I mean, what we've been seeing thus far is that sometimes these lassos end up leading to a commitment that Wings can't necessarily hold on to. Like they still trade relatively evenly in the fights because the gyrocopter pops off his fairly long duration BKB and just gives everybody a very hard time, but his BKB is starting to dwindle somewhat. At least Wings now have this Blink Dagger up on the line, so they don't only have one form of initiation to try and jump in and get this Storm and burst him down, because if you're Wings, that's definitely what you're aiming to do here. The Shadow Fiend is going to be a little bit more of a problem, let's say 5 minutes time, since he will be able to pick up another item and actually start contributing more with the right click. But for now, the Storm definitely has to be the big target if you're TongFu. We are starting to drag in a little bit, and you talked about the potential for TongFu to hold onto the high ground with the blast, and I mean also even just TP zips from base to clear out waves and whatnot. We've seen that from
recall zips.
You could go for recall zips as well. And I guess that's where we should potentially start talking a little bit about the late game. I mean, I feel like it's reasonably evenly matched, but I do give TongFu the edge just because they've got the sort of the three full cores. Though I don't want to discount the Batrider's late game potential too much. He is one of the scariest heroes of pretty much all stages of the game once he has his core farm up.
Yeah, definitely. So you can definitely see Wings there, you know, spreading up a little bit. The fact that XDD is up on top lane alone and the rest of the heroes are off the map kind of indicates to TongFu, okay, they'll be sitting behind the gyrocopter, but in fact, they're moving towards the middle lane and probably looking to defend their own tier 2 and defend their own jungle. But TongFu, they don't want to go into a 5v5 head-on-head here.
Yeah,
I mean, they kind of want to draw wings into them.
I think they're just Aegis dodging at the moment, honestly. It's just now being reclaimed, so they did a pretty successful job of not taking a fight into that one. And that does mean that they... Now with the Monkey King bar is now up in the gyrocopter, but at least without the Aegis there, they do have the potential to burst him down and win a team fight that way. And I mean, we were just talking about it, right? The late game is probably TongFu's if things drag on a little bit. Though this gyrocopter is huge. I mean, he's a full 5k net worth ahead of anybody in the game right now.
With an MKB done, so Butterfly goes out the window for the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah,
and this is something that I wanted to come to. Shadow Fiend has gone mech BKB. So he's gone, utility, tankiness, survivability. Next, do you go for something like a Skadi, which was the really standard build for 6.83, outside of the, Yule's Blink for Chinese teams? Or do you want to go for something more damage-oriented? Standard Yasha?
Yeah, he's picked up a Yasha thus far. Another Lasso coming in, but there's an immediate press the attack. Red is at the ready. What's even the range on this skill is pretty solid. I haven't actually...
Is it 800?
Yeah, I think it might be a tiny bit less than that. Does the alt hover have it? No, there's no... Okay, I'm just going to have to look it up somewhere. But anyway, it's... I think Red's gotten a lot of value out of that this game. I mean, I sort of mentioned it in passing during the draft. I'm like, oh yeah, press the attack. Decent against Batrider. But we've seen it be, I think, far more than...
Monumental.
...than decent this game. Yeah, it's definitely been... very game-breaking.
Cast range is 800.
800, nice. Right on the money.
Oh, yeah.
But Wings just doing their best at the moment to try and sort of press TongFu into their base right now. They've got a couple of wards placed to keep eyes over on the dire jungle, and TongFu just doing their best to keep on slow pushing and keep these lanes out at the moment. And they're being pretty successful. I think the one thing about Wings is that they're trying to do this as a group of five, And that means that they're always competing against the fact that TongFu are split up. And they can split push and counter push really nicely with this Keeper of the Light. So I feel like so long as TongFu don't slip up, they can kind of just keep repeating this cycle and never really let Wings get over onto their side of the map. Of course, if Wings get a crucial smoke or a crucial lasso, then that can definitely open things up. But I feel like for now, we could be sitting here in this kind of holding pattern for a little while.
It's kind of like, watching tennis where TongFu...
They're just rallying.
Yeah, it's just back and forth. But I agree. Batrider and Lion, I wouldn't be surprised to see them smoke up with maybe plus one and go and look for a solo pickoff in the enemy jungle. Try and get that one kill that allows them to then regroup as five, push towards tier threes and either force buyback or force a head-on-head fight. Because that's what Wings want. They want a 5v5 so they can get cooldown, soul assumptions, and use their mech and really play optimally. TongFu, they just want to keep on farming. You've touched on it a couple of times, their tri-core. Bounty Hunter, I'd even throw in there and say maybe is a fourth or, is a three and a half core. But they've definitely got the capabilities here. And as I'm saying this, TongFu, they know... is it Aegis Immortal gone?
Yeah, it's been gone for a while. And they're going to jump in here. They're looking for the Viper. They're bursting him down at the start. Familiar's coming in. They get the drops. They get the Flame right back. It opens up a little bit of space. But the duel is still going to go the way of the Legion Commander. And with the Viper down, I don't think Wings should be too interested in fighting this. But they do go jumping in. They get the Hex off onto Kabu. Buyback comes out instantly. But Kabu manages to pop off the BKB. And now he gets to go to work. U9 being focused for the time being by XCD, who's just right-clicking away, but he's in the middle of three TongFu heroes. He's winning the fight at the moment. The Rocket Barrage doing huge damage. Kabu locked down.
XCD.
Oh, last auto attack's not going to be enough. XCD picks up the Beyond God.
Kabu has no mana. But it's only in July. It's a bad rider.
He's got 18 Bloodstone charges. He's getting mana back.
From 0 to 200 in about 2 seconds.
Yeah. Anyway, so fight ends up being 3-for-3 with a buyback. Viper does manage to make it back and do a decent amount of damage, so I think the buyback ended up being somewhat worth it there. And it's interesting to me that it was TongFu who...
initiated.
They went for that fight, and I guess they could have just disengaged after they got the Viper kill. And they were probably thinking what I was thinking, like, why on earth would Wings fight us when they have no Viper? But it turns out that this gyrocopter is just a monster right now. And XCD...
Does he buy a Reaver now?
He's got another 3.8k. I think, you just buy the Reaver, you work on Satanic.
Yeah.
The damage from the Shadow Fiend is going to scale up a little bit more, I think, from this point forward. Probably starts... Even if he's tanking up, it's probably going to be tank slash damage that he ends up going for, and you know the Legion Commander's damage is only going to grow as well. So I like the decision from XCD to just go for that.
I think a big turning point here for TongFu when it goes from Wings winning 5v5 is going to be the Hex on Storm. He's building into it. If they can get that Zip Hex onto Gyro, Viper no longer becomes the main target. They don't want to get rid of that mech as soon as possible. They go for the Gyro, kill him off as quickly as they can with Hex, Duel, get the track and throw Shuriken down, try and kill him. But then the scary thing is, if you don't finish him off, Satanic comes out, BKB, he's back to full health and you've thrown away a lot of your initiation power.
Yeah, Roshan's respawned and Wings want it. They're scouting it a little bit with Injuli. Keeping tabs on thing, Blast comes through. Kabu, can he get in there and swipe? It won't be able to. XCD, and the lasso comes out. Kabu did manage to pop his BKB off, but the right clicks might be enough. Red goes jumping in, gets the duel off onto Super, does manage to bring him down, but it's going to end up being dropped by XDD.
The DD Gyrocopter not something you want to mess with inside that Roshan pit. You can see Kabu and Yuna just like, nah, we're not going in there.
Kabu fortunately manages to survive out of the day, so keeps those Bloodstone charges intact, which are starting to look like they might become a bigger deal, because it feels like the teamfights are slowly but surely marching towards the TongFu base. They managed to take a couple of fights over on the Radiant side, but for the most part, Wings have sort of kept them over on the Dire side of the map, and that's where an instant respawn on your Storm Spirit could be really huge, especially now that BKB durations are starting to dwindle somewhat. 7 seconds on the Gyrocopter, I think it's 8 seconds on the Storm Spirit, and Shadow Fiend is also at 8 seconds right now. So still a little while until they start to get into really scary territory, but something to keep in mind as we move a little bit further forward. But I mean, Wings, they've got the Aegis and they've got the Satanic now, so
it's
in their mind, it's go time.
Yeah, exactly. And TongFu do not have that Hex on the Storm yet. He's still relatively far away from it.
Yeah.
Are they going to smoke? Are they going to go outside of their base and look for something? Because defending their base is of utmost importance. They've got both side lanes pushing out, which is great. Going to be up to Indelai to push out this bot lane. They've got familiars pushing mid.
They've only got the one smoke for an eternity at the moment. They've just picked up this one on Melody Lovers, and I think it's out of stock for 11 minutes or something, so... Gonna have to be pretty conservative with that. Like we were talking about earlier, they do have the spam to fall back on. They've got the overwhelming odds. They've got the blast as well. So
is it enough against the BKB gyro on your high ground?
This gyrocopter is just too terrifying. XDD doesn't even really care if his creeps survive. So long as they get up there and disable backdoor protection, he can. I mean, even if he has to go up and hit the building and then retreat to the jungle and lifesteal backup off Satanic. That could be all it takes. Kabu getting lasso top lane, right back into the Hex. I think they've got the chain stun here. Soul Assumption coming in as well, and that is going to be a very swift death for the Storm Spirit. But a very swift respawn as well, as Kabu is already back.
Look at me!
I even saw the Finger of Death animation flying over towards the Dire Fountain because he respawned so quickly.
Legion mid lane though, catches XDD, they've got the blade mail up and Storm zips forward, they're going to get this first kill. Legion's Immortal is expended, but LPC, the rest of Wings are coming in to catch them all. Bounty Hunter, who's going to stun him, who's going to slow him? It looks like it's just XDD ripping apart with Rocket Barrage, and TongFu on the retreat, tail between legs, running the hell away. I just had some more delay. Red only got one bounty kill there. For some reason he had the animation pop up a second time, but there was no second kill.
Yeah, there's some interesting things happening. Shadow Fiend's going to TP and then immediately get recalled. A little bit of miscommunication there from TongFu, but for now they're, I think, just kind of telling themselves that they need to hold the line as best they can. They are up against a gem, I believe, over on the Wing side, yet there's a gem over on Injuli, and that's part of the reason why it's been so difficult for TongFu to really establish themselves on the map. They don't have any real ward control, and they've still only got this one smoke over on Melody Lovers. I mean, the smoke doesn't even really count for a whole lot, because when you can't see anything, you're smoking completely blind, and it could actually end up hurting you more than helping if you end up taking a fight at a poor location. So I feel like TongFu are just sort of settling in for the long haul at this point. They've still got plenty of space to farm up. I mean, the Shadow Fiend has plenty of slots. The Storm Spirit can still grab a bunch of items, but they do go for the smoke. I think the Hex is now complete as they pass the secret shop, so that could be the difference maker here.
Oh, is it on the courier?
Oh,
he's got the Void Stone on the courier.
Yeah. Well, he's just forgotten that Void Stone isn't in the in the secret shop anymore.
Oopsie.
Yeah, it happens to the best of us.
Now, this is the second or third time that TongFu, where we're thinking, okay, they've got the better late game, they've got some great counter
pushing
abilities.
They leave the base, and they go smoke.
They go for the aggressive pickoff. Now,
yeah, it's weird.
Granted, it did kind of work initially on that Viper kill. It's just then the disengage, which is a problem for them.
Yeah.
They've got Blinks and Ball Lightning to get out, but it's the actual choice. Do we continue fighting? And if the answer is yes, I do feel a little bit worried.
Yeah, I think it was a little bit of a weird time to smoke, because I don't know if you're necessarily looking for a kill there. I feel like in a couple of minutes time, when Roshan is potentially up, that's where the higher value smoke might be, because if you win a fight then and you're TongFu, you can definitely take Roshan decently quickly. I feel like that smoke may have been called by the Keeper of the Light, and he just wanted to go out and get another ward. So they don't have the smoke ready for Roshan, but they do hopefully have this Observer ward primed and ready to go. And TongFu sticking around top lane, hoping that they can get this pickoff on XDD. Is he going to poke his head forward? It looks like as everybody retreats back into the fog, TongFu's nerve is going to break a little bit, and they're just going to go back to farming.
This is kind of interesting for me, because they were shoving bottom lane pretty hard. They've got, you know, pretty much double creep wave, one catapult, visage familiars. They were grouped up as five. Are you really worried about TongFu getting a tier 2 at top and then returning to base to defend their tier 3s when you're so strong right now? And I guess they didn't see the hex.
I think they're respecting the Storm Spirit.
Yeah.
I think that's the biggest thing right now. They know that that forcing up into the high ground against the Storm Spirit is going to be a very tough proposition. And I think they also feel that they've got better control around Roshan. So I feel like at the moment it's TongFu just playing a Void and farm, and Wings are just waiting for Roshan to grab that and then try and make another play. With another Aegis on over on their Gyrocopter. Do you have another couple of items coming out as well? We've actually got a Heaven's Halberd picked up for your Viper, which I find a little bit
against Legion. Oh no, Legion has BKB though.
Yeah, and you also can't be disarmed while you're dueling anyway.
Yeah.
So it's a little bit strange. It does help him in terms of just getting dueled by the Legion and his survivability there, but I feel like he also could have just maybe started working towards an AC if that was his big concern. You know, even just the plate mail would have helped a lot, but we'll see. The Shadow Fiend's BKB is starting to wear down a little bit. We haven't actually seen another charge used since the last time I mentioned that, so it's still on the 8 seconds available. But yeah, for now, I'm a bit dubious about the Heaven's Halberd, but we'll see what he ends up doing.
Yeah, the Visage is close to Aghanim Scepter as well. 1,200 already gone towards that point booster, so another 400, and he's got that completed. In July, has a haste rune here with Force, Blink, Gem. He's already hunted down the majority of the Dire Wards, and you look at the vision that TongFu actually have, limited to one next to the Roshan pit, so they'll count themselves lucky that they have that at the very least.
Yeah, and I think Bat actually threw a sticky napalm up there, but might have just been out of range with True Sight on the ward or something along those lines, so that ward, fortunately for TongFu, still standing, but I feel like Wings maybe not doing just a minor misplay, not catching it, since they were actually hunting in that area. TongFu outside of the base at the moment, sort of setting up on the high ground for now. Roshan is getting into territory where he could potentially respawn. It's going to be a relatively long respawn time here, about 2 minutes to go, but this is where we're definitely going to start seeing posturing around the pit, and I feel like that's actually where TongFu have a little bit of an advantage. They have a small advantage because they can kind of split push, but the danger, of course, is that Wings do have very good jump with both the Batrider and the Lion. So as much as you can look at it and say, oh, the Storm Spirit can go and split push and he can get recalled in, there's a chance that while he's split pushing, he just gets jumped and he dies and they lose Roshan because of that. So I feel like both teams just kind of sticking around by the pit at the moment and waiting to see.
Oh, they're going to jump now. Batrider goes in and found LPC. Pretty easy pick off here. If they can get it, XDD though, manning up. Flank cannon enabled, and he's turning it back around. Red not taking too much damage though. XDD needs to pop the Satanic now. Call down, not yet launched, will be launched now as the rockets fall. Kabu taken out by Gyro and U9 fighting, manning up. Kills off XDD at the very end. And now, looking like he's gonna get dropped by Super. Yep, his HP bar goes from like half to zero in a split second.
On Gyrocopter, they focused everything on Gyrocopter that fight,
yeah,
and they just couldn't kill him.
And then Satanic.
And then, yeah. And XCD was even hitting a blade mail. I think he was hitting the Legion Commander's blade mail when he popped his Satanic and wasn't gaining all that much HP because there was some damage getting pushed back onto him.
But he wasn't losing.
He was still just fine, sustained through everything. Did end up dropping in the end, but by that point, the Viper had already used all of that space to just sit there auto-attacking everything down. And they do end up buying back on the Gyrocopter, but Roshan hasn't respawned just yet. So I think XCD getting a little bit ahead of himself there. He was probably thinking, Roshan is definitely up, so I'm going to buy back, and it won't matter because I can go and just get the Aegis so we can go and end the game right now. But as they're going to see, Roshan's only now just popped up, and it looks like TongFu are going to have a pretty big opportunity with that buyback being down and a relatively long respawn
this hits
coming up for the Gyrocopter.
At the time when Super has triple familiars, but the big fear is that if Gyro dies now, he has no buyback.
Yeah, that it's definitely a concern for Wings. They're moving over towards the pit right now, though. They know that they need this Aegis. I guess he probably ends up dropping the Talisman here. Melody Lover's going to start blasting and harassing a little bit here in July, looking for something, but the jump actually comes back the opposite way. LPC being focused. They've got another duel coming out. Familiar dropped over the top of everything else. In the middle of the fight, though, it is going to end up being the Legion Commander brought down. A couple more tracks going out as Injuli continues pursuit. Yules up onto the Keeper of the Light. LPC trying to escape, but the homing missile is chasing him down. Injuli dancing on the edge of the cliff right now as XCD just forces everybody back with the right clicks. Kabu, a little bit of mana left. But yeah, the flat cannon just clearing up. Kabu does manage to make it back to base, but his team is in shambles, and Wings are going to go claim their prize, probably grab that Roshan and head towards the high ground.
For TongFu here, Shadow Fiend is their teamfight hero. Bounty Hunter is like a conduit. He helps out. He throws track and shuriken and starts things off. Legion Commander blinks in and gets the duel onto Gyrocopter, but Satanic had already been popped at that point. But without Requiem, the slow and the debuff on damage, without the mech, Shadow Fiend just wasn't a factor there. So they were kind of 4v5 with Shadow Fiend sort of lurking in the background and not really doing too much. Now Roshan going to the way of XDD.
Yeah, and he is ready to accept that Aegis has got another 2k gold as well. So not even that far away from being able to grab a butterfly and having that one floating around on the courier for when his Aegis does end up being popped. And yeah, like you said, I feel like we didn't see a ton of impact out of the Shadow Fiend in that last fight. He is fairly tanky with the Eye of Skadi and the SNY, so I feel like he does need to be getting involved. And I feel like next item probably just needs to be, if not sort of straight up damage,
it has to be MKB.
Huh? Oh yeah, I guess it does just have to be MKB. If he's seen the Heaven's Halberd already on the Viper,
and
he's
talisman.
Seen a Talisman, and it's actually the Butterfly already completed on the Gyrocopter. Did he sell something for this?
Did he have drums?
Yeah,
I know he had drums, but did he have it recently?
I feel like it may have still been in his inventory, so that might have been it, because he wasn't this close to Butterfly. But yeah, anyway, so we've got that picked up. He's got the Aegis sitting in his inventory for another 4 minutes time, and TongFu just have to figure out what they can do.
There's a ton of unspent gold here for Wings. You're looking at 5,000 on InJuli. The Viper has 3 grand with cheese and vitality booster. Lion, 720, not too shabby. Butterfly just purchased, like you said. And then 1,000 over on the Visage. Well, you look at TongFu, and they don't have, two pennies to rub together. They've sure got the Shadow Fiend, who has a Demon Edge and 1,800 gold, but...
Oh my god, refresh.
You need buyback. You need buyback on these TongFu heroes, and Storm is the only one with it. The one hero that you're kind of like, okay, well, with... he's only got 9 Bloodstone Charges. I thought maybe that was a little bit higher, but he's not going to have the instant respawn. He does still need buyback. You want it on the Shadow Fiend, you want it on every single hero, preferably over on TongFu.
I feel like with the way that buyback works now, there is more value in just... Oh, LPC caught out once again. X, Finger, can they help him out? Kabu comes rolling in. Who's going to be able to grab? It's actually... him who's going to get grabbed. Kabu in some trouble. The second lasso also coming out. Kabu won't get to do a single thing this fight. Red jumps in with the duel over on the Viper, but it does basically nothing as he just gets right-click down, and now it's U9's turn getting hexed up. Can they do anything to get him out of here? Keeper of the Light just throws up his hands and runs back into the base as TongFu end up losing four for absolutely nothing in return.
It's going to be difficult. And XDD is just going to regen everything up, pops the Satanic, says thanks for the full health. Aegis Immortal still available, of course, so he's going to plonk himself down up on that high ground, take an Illuminate to the face. He even dodges through it, so doesn't care too much. Another Illuminate, but Melody Lover's going to keep the spam going. Double buyback here, Legion Commander and Shadow Fiend storm alive in 9 seconds time. XDD, he is going to be the taker of this damage if they do actually go, but Wings playing it safe for now. Backing up a little bit, but is this a fakey? Is this the fake back up and then turn around and go ham?
I think there's a team discussion right now about whether or not the Aegis is worth... So they've only got one lasso at the moment. So either they can have the Refresher Orb back off cooldown from the Batrider, or they can have the Aegis, but they can't have both. But I think they're just going to end up going with the Aegis anyway. One lasso should be sufficient to kill Kaba. The only reason that they needed two last fight was because it took such a long time for the damage dealers to get into position with just how that started out. So yeah, Wing's just gonna keep on sieging.
MKB animation on top of towers. The jump in from Red finds a duel. XDD just gonna give up his life here. They don't really care too much. If he can turn and fight, that's great for them, and it looks like he will do. Satanic's popped, he turns, he regens up. Rank's gonna fall here. ZY, the Viper, the jump in. Kabu caught with the lasso. Do they have the chain stuns? It looks like they do. Hex out, stun, call down, finished. And that's a Storm having to buy back with your Legion dead for 70 seconds. What do you actually do to win this team fight? Kabu picks up two in the back end. The Shuriken bounces back onto that Batrider, but he keeps looking for more, and there just isn't more to be had. XDD's back alive with full HP. ZY, pretty healthy on this Viper with that Heart of Tarrasque regen kicking in now as he leaves the base. U9 on this Shadow Fiend, trying to quell the hordes of creeps and illusions that just take down that ranged Rax after melee fell a good 10, 20 seconds ago.
Kabu still trying to get a little bit more value out of this buyback. Keeps on zipping forward, but XTD and ZY, they're both still on full HP. Kabu's getting right-click, needs to be a little bit careful. Hex comes out, but there isn't any follow-up, and XTD has the Satanic off cooldown. Blinding Light's going to be a bit of a nuisance,
There's no BKB for SF for 10 seconds. They're not going to chase.
I mean, at this point, the decision is almost totally on Wings about whether or not they actually want to fight it. I think the right decision is just to back up. They've got two heroes dead, they've got no Batrider, and they don't really have any incentive to take this fight here on the middle lane. So they're going to end up backing up. I think they did pretty well for themselves in that fight. We haven't actually shown the graphs at all, really, this game, but it's a 20k experience lead and about a 15k, almost 20k net worth lead in Wings' favor right now. So things definitely looking good for them. And they're just so tanky. They keep pouring damage into the Gyrocopter, and he doesn't go down, and he gets the Satanic off and survives that way. And the Viper is just... totally not even an option at the moment with the Heaven's Halberd
TongFu
and the Heart.
Kind of always been on the back foot this game. They've always been the ones defending and never the ones being the aggressors, except for, you know, certain pickoffs or...
It's a lineup thing as well, to an extent. I mean, I feel like the Bounty Hunter is somewhat aggressive and pickoff oriented, but I feel like putting the Legion Commander in the lineup and having the three sort of full carry-oriented cores... naturally just pushes you towards the
Like, the fact that Keeper of the Light picks up a gem 51 minutes into the game, while the Batrider has had his already for 30 minutes, it's kind of indicative of that. But I feel this is also showing that TongFu, you know they're not down and out. They're one Rax down, or one lane of Rax down, against a relatively early peaking lineup here. Gyrocopter is the epitome of all eggs in one basket. Yeah. They don't have any fallback plan, really. The Viper did show a couple of teamfights ago that he can stand and fight. But if Gyro dies and doesn't have Aegis Immortal, he's actually got a Moonshard over on him.
Yeah, I just caught that. So, I mean, as much as people talk about, like, oh, Gyrocopter, you know, he does all of his damage during Flak Cannon, and then he's less impressive. He's got a perfectly acceptable, just straight right-clicking and man-fighting build now. And the AoE damage, how quickly all of the Flak Cannon shots are going to come out. Well, I'm worried for, say, the Keeper of the Light and the Bounty Hunter.
On single targets, he's doing a ton of damage. Was it 0.42 attacks per second, and he's doing 340. That's nuts.
Yeah, we'll just watch some heroes and some buildings drop, and you'll see exactly how quickly this Gyrocopter clears through its wings. There's a mana leak over on the Viper, but he doesn't care at all. They're just going to clean up the second lane of Rax. Jump in initiation. Red looking for it over onto XCD. Can they keep him alive this time around? He's good, just going to keep on right-clicking, and he's life-stealing up. Blade Mail gets popped, but XCD with his Satanic just laying waste to everything. TongFu already lost one. They're going to lose the Shadow Fiend. There's a Lasso on the back lines as well. Kabu trying to get something done, but I mean, we're still above 50% health on everyone over on the wing side. And looks like this could be the end of it very, very soon. Injuli just keeping them back at the fountain.
That lasso from Injuli catching Shadow Fiend. They wanted to duel Requiem and just kill the Gyrocopter outright. It was kind of their last-ditch effort. Let's see what we can do, guys. Jump in and try and blow everything on him. But the lasso from Injuli just didn't allow for it. Dragged back the SF, took him down, made sure that there was no Requiem forthcoming. But that's it for this game here. 1-0 for Wings against TongFu in this two-game series.
And things really not looking good for TongFu now. That's 0-3 out of three games. Yeah. And I mean, when it's only a five-man group and you're not favored against some of the other... I feel like they've faced... I mean, you know, fair enough. The first opponent that they faced, HGT, maybe not 100% favored there, but Wings is definitely a team that... you're looking to beat if you're advancing.
Dropping a game here really does hinder their chances of advancing.
I don't want to take anything away from Wings either, though. I feel like they played really, really well. Like I don't feel that this is a failing on the part of TongFu. I feel like this is Wings. They had their lineup. They executed well. They knew exactly what they wanted to do. And TongFu just felt somewhat uncomfortable, honestly.
Solid draft from Wings. Overall game plan, it seemed very well-honed. They had obviously practiced this, and Gyrocopter, you know, he's a popular hero, but the fact that they had four heroes around him that could make a lot happen in teamfights, he became the main target. The Viper, still, you know, very tanky. They couldn't focus him. You know, you said it just wasn't an option. While LPC on this Bounty Hunter, early on, he did very little. It was kind of dead weight.
Yeah, they second picked it. It seemed like they had a lot of confidence, and... It seems like Wings kind of had the answers. I feel like some of the... Since Bounty Hunter sort of in this fourth position, especially in China, has only been a recent thing. Maybe some teams have been getting caught out by it a little bit. But if we're going to talk about anyone, let's not talk about LPC. Let's talk about this guy up on the screen right now. XDD, what a game on Gyrocopter. 21-2. 750 GPM. You look at that inventory, and he was just stacked.
The most important stat, though, is fantasy points is 21. It's not up on the screen, but I've got it on mine. No, but seriously, that guy, he farmed very well. His aggression showed, but also the fact that he knew exactly when he needed to back off. He knew exactly when he was in a position where, okay, I can tank duel, I can tank this, I can tank the storm coming in and hexing me, and I'm on 200 HP. Let's satanic, let's BKB and turn this fight around. Every single time, he's thinking, hang on. He's gone a little bit too far here. The rest of his team are, you know, deep 600 range, 1,000 range. But he knew the limits of his hero, the advantages that he could get from actually pushing that fast. So great, great play by him. Yep. But also great team effort. TongFu, they've got another game to show themselves in this two-game series. We'll see in a couple of minutes whether they'll be able to draw it up. Or can Wings take the 2-0 swing? I'm Durka. Joining me is, oh my God. I'm so sleepy. Basekip.
Hey.
I wanted to call you Blaze. My brain was like, Blaze. It's not Blaze, it's Basekip. I'm so sorry. I'm going to go and hide in the corner.
It's all right.
But we'll be back in a couple of minutes.
See you guys soon.